Coastal archaeology is rapidly changing our view of British history. It's a vital tool for archaeologists to understand better how we lived and worked in the past.
Every day on a sandy beach or a rocky foreshore, intriguing evidence of our island history appears and then disappears as the tide rolls out and rolls back in again.
The area between high and low water marks is known as the intertidal zone. And at low tide, the sea reveals a wealth of valuable clues.
What is that?
What is that?
There's a lot of theories.
Investigating these fragments brings to life the story of Britain's coastal history.
Archaeologists are enthusiastic about their discoveries, but they're also worried. Extreme weather can expose long hidden remains. At the same time, these conditions can damage or even destroy our valuable archaeological heritage.
And because there's no guarantee this legacy from the past will survive into the future, coastal archaeologists are busy identifying what's most at risk. This week, the Britain at Low Tide team is on the stunning north coast of Kent. We'll be following the excavation of one of the most significant shipwreck discoveries of recent times.
Even though it's partial, what remains of it is exceptionally well preserved. That makes it quite a special thing.
What is this mysterious sandbar? Is it natural? How has it affected the lives of local people?
Visitors that came would see something rather like hell.
And we'll explore the forgotten military base that helped win World War I.
It was top secret. I don't think the Germans were aware of it, and one of the reasons they weren't aware of it was a ludicrous place to build it.
The stretch of coastline we're interested in lies on the north coast of Kent, around the town of Whitstable. Whitstable is one of the fastest growing seaside resorts in Britain. In the last decade, tourist numbers have soared. People come here for the famous natural oysters, the miles of shingle beach, and of course, the sea. What's less well known is the wealth of archaeology in the intertidal zone. And to investigate what's there, I'm joining our team of specialist archaeologists.
We look at these seaside towns and we see them all as pleasure, but that's fairly recent. They're actually hives of industry.
We're starting with this mysterious shingle bar, close to Whitstable, that only emerges twice a day for a very few hours at low tide.
This is a rather enigmatic feature sandbar, which I guess is where we're headed.
It is, yeah. It's quite unique for the area. There's nothing else quite like it around here. And that's why no one's exactly sure what it is.
Have you got a name?
I do have a name for you, yeah. We are now walking team on the street.
Is it a promenade of some kind?
Well, I mean, there's lots of people promenading on it today. And actually, when it's at the lowest of tides, you can promenade quite far out here. It goes the best part of 3/4 of a mile. And our fellow beach makers are very handily pointing out just how far it'll go.
Yeah, look at them.
The street has baffled archaeologists and residents alike for decades. It's an intriguing name for what looks like a causeway that goes nowhere. Could this geological oddity help shed light on the story of Whitstable's past?
I thought perhaps it'd be easier for us to have a bit of a look at some postcards. I've got some Victorian Edwardian era postcards. Here you go, Charlotte.
Yeah,
have a look at these. They show quite a different scene to today.
It's changed loads. This one here, this looks like salt marsh, whereas now, I mean, it's all pretty much shingle and sand, isn't it? And it's much wider, and I mean, that looks a lot higher as well.
And this is my favourite, this little sort of hand-drawn one. We've got folks in their finest frocks and gowns going for a walk. In the summer months, fishermen would actually give pleasure boat rides. So we may actually have sort of an early pleasure pier, I suppose.
We're promenading. They've been promenading back into the 19th century. I mean, is that why it's called the street? Well, could it be?
The street is an interesting name in that it's often used in the olden days to demark a Roman routeway like Hermin Street or Watling Street. The term street is very specific.
Does that mean you can just sort of say that if something's got street after its name, there's a suggestion that it might have been a road at one time?
A major thoroughfare.
The street is one of Whitstable's standout landmarks. Despite years of rising sea levels and coastal erosion, it survived. But how? And in what ways has it shaped and developed the people and the town of Whitstable? This part of the Kentish coast has always been a busy waterway. For centuries, navigable shipping lanes to London in one direction and the continent in the other have made it a perfect location for industry.
Which is why archaeologists are fascinated by the recent exposure of a wreck in the intertidal zone at Tankerton. Was it connected to one of these local industries?
Oliver is heading over to Tankerton now, where a Dawn excavation is about to start. Tankerton is just minutes from the street, so could the wreck throw some light on its history? When the boat was first discovered in 1996, no one realised how important it was, before it promptly vanished again under the mud. Then, in 2017, it reappeared. Archaeologists now have a real chance to investigate it properly, but it's an excavation nightmare. The tides mean it will only be accessible for a very few days. So it's now or never. The tide won't be as low again for the rest of the year.
Excavation in the intertidal zone, it's not a straightforward thing. What do you expect to encounter while you're excavating the wreck?
Well, we've only got a tidal window of a few hours. We're going to pump the water out, bail that out, put in a number of trenches across the site. There should be plenty of items that give clues to what it was doing, who was living on it, maybe.
This kind of excavation is unlike an archaeological dig on land and unlike a diving expedition at sea. It has its own distinctive problems.
We're going to get collapsed deck structure in the actual fill of the hull. So as we go down, it's not going to be a nice, clean trench that we can excavate down. We're likely to get bits of material that we have to deal with. And, of course, when the tide does come in, you get material coming into the trenches that you've been excavating, which you then have to re-excavate, re-clean. So it's a bit of a battle against the sea.
Without doubt, this is one of Britain's most exciting maritime discoveries. But we don't know how this boat came to be here. Was it built locally? Toby and his team have just a few days to find out all they can. Above all, they want to know how old the boat is. Could it have been connected with our enigmatic feature, the street? One of the industries Whitstable was once famous for was the manufacture of copperas. I'm meeting Tim Allen.
Hey, Tim.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Who excavated the landward end of the street in the 1990s. He came to realise how important copperas was to the people and economy of this area.
It had so many uses. Principal use to make dye fixative, another use to make ink, another use medicinal, another use you could actually produce sulphur. And of course, from sulphur, you can make gunpowder.
Yes. So a massively versatile product, yes. Presumably very valuable.
Very valuable. It's said that an ounce of copperas was worth more than an ounce of gold.
In that sense, did the copperas industry kind of basically make Whitstable what it is?
Well, it did. If you think of Whitstable in, let's say, 1560, it's fishing and boats, that's what it's all about. And suddenly, this massive new industry grows up.
Tell me about the copperas industry. Start with what the copperas industry was.
Well, it's formed from a stone which occurs here in profusion, iron pyrites.
Now, I happen to have some, because we found some on the street.
That is the very material.
Yeah, look at that. Yes. So, yeah, a bit of fossilised Eocene wood there.
Now, it's put in large beds. It's left to weather. It took a minimum of 4 years for it to produce the required liquid from which they made copperas. The solution is then boiled. It's then drained off into a cistern and it's allowed to stand and it begins to congeal and it makes a crystal, which is green. And it's a beautiful green. It looks like grapes.
Was it exactly here that you excavated?
Exactly here, but about 2 metres down.
So how did you come to, you know, to remove all this shingle and actually find the material there in the first place?
Well, there was a big storm and it exposed these triangular timbers and they were sticking up and they were sharp. The erosion had made them sharp, like so. You can see them here. And they were considered to be a threat, and they were a threat. So the council said, we need to deal with this.
So you dug down here, and in this picture, we're looking at...
The triangles, we think, with confidence, are the supports for planking. And this is the actual seawall that they made. So this is basically a wharf.
And the street feels like a really important natural feature that you could use for the copper industry. Are the two connected?
They are very much connected. They use the street here to bring ships in and to ship the copperas out.
The archaeological remains of the copperas industry are now buried under shingle at the landward end of the street. But Tim's evidence has identified a connection between the two. From the late 1500s, it appears that it provided a deep water haven to moor boats. But how old, I wonder, is that name, the street?
This is intriguing because it actually says street.
It does.
We're in North Kent, investigating the intertidal archaeology along the coast. We want to find out what it can tell us about the role this part of Kent has played in the country's history. Charlotte and I are travelling to Sandwich and Pegwell Bay. Much of this coast struggles with erosion, but around this northeastern corner, on the stretch between Ramsgate and Sandwich, there's a different problem, and that's silt. The place we're going to has some pretty lethal mud at low tide, and on foot, we might not be able to reach it. So we're taking a boat in the company of Kent archaeologist Andrew Richardson.
We've left Ramsgate, we're heading towards the mouth of the River Stour, and what we're going to see are the remains of Port Richborough, which was at the end of the First World War, became perhaps the most important logistical port for supplying men and war materials to the Western Front.
It was a port, but we've left the open seas and we're now heading up a river, and a rather shallow one at that.
Yeah. It isn't an obvious place. It was top secret. I don't think the Germans were aware of it, and one of the reasons they weren't aware of it was a ludicrous place to make it. The way they got over that was investment in dredging.
It's the 100th anniversary of this extraordinary site. Peel back a century and the whole of this riverbank would have been a vast military depot covering 2,000 acres and employing 20,000 people. There's nothing much left of it today. It's silted up and overgrown. But at low tide, the remains of a jetty are visible. This, apparently, is where Britain's first cross-channel train ferries used to dock in 1918.
So is that part of the port structure?
Yeah, so we're at the northern end, and this on the plans is marked as the ferry berth. So really, this is the business end of the whole operation.
Where's it all gone?
Some really major engineering went into creating the place, and my hope would be when we get ashore that we'll find a lot of the wharfs and so on actually will still be there poking out the grass.
OK, that's it?
Yeah, good.
While Charlotte and Andrew investigate the site for any archaeological remains, I'm joining historian Martin Watts, who's researched the background to this little-known military depot.
This place seems like it would have been enormous.
It's just amazing. They built a whole, virtually a small town. So they had a foundry, they had shipyards, hospitals. They were completely self-contained.
What's the first reason for building this here?
They needed to increase significantly the number of men, munitions and supplies to the army from 1916 onwards. They first concentrated on barges. The French have an excellent inland waterway system, and the barges alone carried 750,000 tonne of ammunition, 70,000 tonne of supplies, and they brought back 150,000 tonnes of salvage. What followed on from the barges was an idea to build train ferries. The train ferries, which operated from this berth here, they called the system roll-on, roll-off.
When you say roll-on, roll-off, what do you actually mean?
Well, the ferries had 1,000 foot of railway track on them, so the trains could drive straight onto the ferry. These ferries could turn around in 20 minutes. Hmm. So you could increase the frequency and the number of journeys to and from France. And the key to it was the construction of a link, which enabled the road and the railway to be at the right level.
The link basically was just a bridge that could move up and down.
Move up and down. And it cost £98,000, which is a lot of money now.
That is a lot of money.
Well, a modern link would cost you somewhere in the region of 10 million, I suppose, if you had put one in at Dover. So I suppose that's quite comparable.
And that, presumably, was all new.
That's, yes,
so it's not just an expensive piece of kit. It's a bespoke, invented piece of kit for this new technology.
You've got this standing archaeology.
But I think there's a lot of buried archaeology. I mean, you can see we've got iron bolts here,
another
one here, so something substantial was fixed on here. The plan shows the railway lines converging more or less on this point.
That's right.
Between this shorter jetty and the longer jetty up there.
So we can see this line of this wharf along here, the long one that goes right out.
The long, thin jetty that's marked as train ferry on the plan. On this side, you've got a shorter, wider jetty.
Yeah,
this
you can see
little
the line.
Stream here has exposed the timbers of it. You could have got a ferry right in here and connected with the link where you're loading the train onto the ferry, which would be berthed in here.
Yeah, well, that's nice, because what we've actually got, you can really see it from this really nice line of posts, following it all the way here, following it here, and then all the way is this actually big wooden U-shaped berth for the boats to come in.
Yeah.
By the start of 1918, the infrastructure was ready. But did these train ferries make a difference to that last year of the war?
Britain and the Allies were relatively close to defeat in the spring of 1918. It got so bad that on the 9th of April 1918, Field Marshal Haig issued his famous backs to the wall. Virtually everybody left to stand and fall where they are now. But it does demonstrate how badly needed Richborough and its supplies were going to be.
It's the first ferry left in
February 1918.
1918, just at that moment where supplies were increasingly needed. At that point, you suddenly have the ability to massively increase the rate at which you are supplying the Western Front.
Field Marshal Haig acknowledged the importance of the port at the end of the war, said it made a significant contribution to victory. Obviously, it was a remarkable engineering achievement, but it also had the significant impact on the outcome of the war on the Western Front.
The success of Port Richborough depended on it remaining a secret from the Germans. But how much did the people of Sandwich know about it? Were any of them involved in running the port? More to investigate. Travelling back towards Whitstable, Oliver is visiting Swalecliff and a very different kind of archaeological site called Long Rock. At low tide, close to the shoreline, a random collection of timbers appears that might just be ancient. The question is, are they evidence of a submerged forest, or was there a human settlement here? First, we need to establish their age. Sir Oliver has joined timber analyst Rod Bale to take some samples for radiocarbon dating.
Looks like a good sample here, then, Rod.
Yeah, this is a great one, I'd say. It's got the bark still attached.
You've pretty easily sawn through that, Rod, and we can see the internal structure of the tree. How is that going to help us with the dating?
Well, we dissect the outermost growth ring below the bark that represents the final year of growth and will contain carbon that was fixed in the tree in that given year. And the radiocarbon, the isotope 14, radiocarbon 14, decays at a known rate, so that can be measured against samples of known age, and we can get a fairly precise date in some instances for that.
Rod had just enough time to get his samples before the sea reclaimed the site.
OK.
So let's get it back up, yeah.
It's clear we'll need to come back if we're to resolve the debate about whether this area in the past was forest or settlement. Our investigation of this coastline has mainly focused on trying to understand this mysterious shingle bar, the street. What role has it played in the shaping and development of Whitstable? Our research has now led us to London and the British Library. I'm here to meet archaeologist Mark Harrison and historian Sandra Dunster, both of them long-term residents of the Whitstable area. Can they help me establish how far back the name, the street, really goes?
How old is this map? What is it?
1698, commissioned by the Admiralty and undertaken by the surveyor Edmund Dummer. And he was tasked to survey the southern English coastline, and in this case, Kent and part of Essex.
What was going on in 1698 that required such a huge amount of effort to go into mapping the coastlines?
What the Admiralty want to do is to ensure that they have sufficient defences around the south coast to make sure that the country is safe. And this is trying to find places where they could build new harbours or where they could build defensive things that would help defend the country.
This is intriguing because it actually says street.
It does.
It actually says street and this is like straight lines, more or less where you'd expect what we call the street today to be. What is it?
It looks like a built structure, doesn't it? And it may well be that it's related to the copperas industry.
Because that's going strong at this point.
That is going very strong at this point. So maybe they did build some sort of jetty, some sort of harbouring there.
But we also know that this area was used as a fishery, where they constructed large wooden fish traps, sometimes known as weirs, but in this area of the country, they're known as kiddles. And we actually have a reference on the reign of Henry VIII in the form of a family will, and I have a transcription here.
1523, I see, it says the street. Well, that's fairly clear. John Breed, at his death in July 1523, left to his son-in-law, Thomas Hockin, who married Alice Breed, his weir at the street. So a weir is a sort of fish trap.
It's a wooden fish trap.
So actual structure, it's not just fishing rights.
No, a very large wooden trap.
I won't say circumstantial because that sounds a bit unfair, but all you've really actually got is a written reference to fisheries, which do sound a bit vague, at a place called the street, which we are having to assume is the same as the street today. I mean, can you be sure there really were substantial fish traps? I feel like I'm not convinced.
Well, we do have another map. We're not quite sure about the exact date. It's listed as either 1514 or 1544. And it is quite stunning, isn't it?
It is stunning. I mean, it's the kind of the immediacy of it, the colours, the fact that you can see the brush strokes. It's almost the sort of naivety there actually makes it more real and more tangible. It feels really modern, just look at it. But I hope you can read this writing, because I cannot.
Well, there's Whitstable there.
Ah, it's Whitstable with an H and a Y.
It is,
right,
yes.
OK, so, yeah, Whitstable. With a Y, OK, Whitstable. Whitstable, OK, right, OK, we're in Whitstable. Yeah. What on earth are these? They look like little people holding spears. Yes. I'm guessing that's not what they are.
So those, we would say, are the fish weirs, the fish traps that were mentioned in the wills.
So you're suggesting that those fish traps here are on what we call the street, or on the street?
Yes.
Yes.
The maps and wills confirm what a fascinating history the street has had. Evidence of the ingenuity with which people can exploit a local resource and turn it century after century to their advantage. But I'm still keen to know how it survived in such an ever-changing coastal environment. Back in Tankerton Bay, the excavation team have exposed a good deal of the hull of the timber boat they're investigating.
This is a first for Britain at low tide. We've never managed to feature an excavation in the intertidal zone before because they are just so difficult. As anybody who's ever built a sandcastle knows, the tide is not your friend sometimes. It comes in twice a day, and all that effort you put in at low tide gets flooded.
It turns out there's a possible link between the wreck and the street. one of the timbers has produced a preliminary date of not earlier than 1531. That overlaps with the date of the Henry VIII map in the British Library.
This is quite slow-grown stuff, isn't it?
Timber expert Damien Goodburn has had his first opportunity to see the wreck. As he discovers more about the boat's construction, it's increasingly clear to him that it may not be a local vessel and may have come from much further afield.
It poses a lot of questions for us. You know, the origin of this vessel is mysterious. The form of the hull, some aspects suggest it might be from somewhere in the Low Countries.
How do you know that? What's...
Well, the way the bow's made, instead of the planks running round the side of the vessel, if you were to stand looking at the front, they're coming up like this.
Yes.
Almost parallel with the keel.
Yeah.
And that's something we see a lot in vessels from that part of the world in more recent times and in the 17th century. And this vessel is mid-16th-ish, roughly, in date, as far as we can see at the moment.
Just by looking at what you can see here, you're already starting to...
Is it
a hypothesis, or
It's totally a speculative hypothesis, and the tree ring work, the dendro work, will sort this out much more. The heavy framing is also another Dutch feature.
Is that unusual? Would you expect to find ships from Netherlands passing by?
Oh, no. It's the nearest part of the continent. It's the Low Countries over there. This is like the M1. This is a major highway and you know, ships move around. This is just where it ended up. It's not in a dock or a harbour. So this is a casual loss. This is like a motorway crash.
So where had the boat come from when it had its motorway crash? Can the design of it and a more precise dating of its timbers identify where it was built?
If we know where the timber was grown, that'll give us a very good indication of where the vessel was constructed.
We're on the northeast coast of Kent investigating the fascinating archaeology of the intertidal zone. So far, we've come across the remarkable remains of a 16th century Tudor wreck, which has already made archaeological history in the area. And we've uncovered some of the secret depot that supplied the British Army in World War I. And then there's the enigma they call the street. We're working on that one. We've decided that the most useful next step towards understanding the street is to carry out a digital drone survey, which will provide the information needed to create a 3D model of the site.
So I've noticed you've got these black and white bullseyes, essentially.
We lay those out, sort of spread across the length of the survey area, and then we record those with a nicely good, accurate GPS. So it basically it'll locate it here in Whitstable, as opposed to just sort of floating in space.
Brilliant, okay, so maybe we should send her up.
Yeah, sure, yeah, definitely. It's a little windy today, but... Yeah, there you can see, there's a few targets in this.
Oh, yeah. So, there. The targets are really clear, aren't they?
Yeah, yeah, it definitely helps that they stand out well. Yeah. So.
And there's us.
Yep.
James is taking hundreds of still photos, each from a different angle, to create a precise digital record of the site. Generally, these surveys take several hours, but James has to complete his in less than two if his cameras are to beat the tide. His results could give us vital clues to the origins of the street.
Yeah, well done.
Just a few minutes away, in Tankerton Bay, Toby Gain and his team have just an hour before the tide returns. But they've made considerable progress since we were last here. Their discoveries have made it a wreck of national importance.
When I look at this boat, I see quite what looks like quite a short vessel. Is that, yeah. I mean, do you get a sense of that shape?
It's not all here, so the stern's missing, so maybe 25% of the vessel is missing at the rear. We think this is the bow, and it's quite a bluff, squat vessel, very heavily built.
Well, have you found anything that tells you something definitive, but tantalising yet?
Well, we've got lots of this collapsed deck structure, so we know it had decks, partial or full. There's part of a knee there, but we've also got what we think might be a galley. So this is where the crew would have cooked food, which is pretty amazing.
How do you know it's the galley?
Well, the bricks, obviously, to protect the wood from the fire.
You've got decks and a galley. You're talking there's a crew. It's not just a few people living on here because they're cooking on here. Do you have any sense of who they would have been yet?
Well, we're starting to get other finds, personal effects of the crew coming up, which is fantastic. This is what we were hoping for. So, for example, just here we've got the sole of a shoe.
Oh, my goodness. But there you go. That is tiny.
It is very
Ooh,
small.
Careful, careful.
Yeah, but these are the kinds of things that will tell us about the human side of this story.
So you can just sense everyone's having a great time and it's thrilling. But I mean, what is the actual significance of a wreck like this?
Wrecks of this date are pretty rare. So we're talking about somewhere in the region of 25 worldwide. Even though it's partial, what remains of it is exceptionally well preserved, and that makes it quite a special thing.
Wow. So this is one of, well, 26 now, right?
26 now.
One of 26 investigated, like properly investigated wrecks of the 1500s in the world.
Yeah, absolutely.
This boat is really remarkable because so much of it is intact and because it's so rare, one of just 26 in the world. As the sea takes back the wreck, the archaeologist's work is over now. But we'll catch up with Toby again, when hopefully he knows more about the boat's origins and how it was used. Another tricky site is the one over at Swale Cliff, Longrock, where the weather has turned nasty. It's unclear what the various timbers are. Could there have been a submerged forest? Or are they evidence of human activity? Damien Goodburn thinks he's found something.
We've got some evidence for some human activity.
Oh, absolutely. Just down here, the grey clay is still on the underside. Can you see that? I haven't even cleaned all that off. This bit was sampled by Rod earlier. I don't know whether he knew it was worked or not, but we can ask him in a minute. And finally, having already looked at this area, I suddenly saw that and thought, I'll just have a little look. Oh, yes, here we are. You know, we've actually got something clearly worked. And you can see cut marks from axes, which are clearly not sharp, wide, flat, modern axes or Roman-style axes, but something earlier could be a rather blunt bronze axe or possibly even a stone axe. This is saying people are here, they're sticking posts in the ground or stakes in the ground from time to time. They may be hunting, they may be catching wildfowl, that kind of thing. They're not living here.
Well, we know we've got a sample on it, so we should go speak to Rod.
Yeah,
he's got a date. Rod?
Hiya. So, from the first sample, which is off the larger oak branch, we have a conventional radiocarbon age of 3480 plus or minus 30 BP. So, with a 95.4% probability of between 1888 to 1737 Cal BC, and a much lesser probability.
What's that in English?
Okay, well, on, Rob, it's early Bronze Age.
Why didn't you tell us?
Okay, well, there you go. Yeah. So that's the first one. The other one is off a much smaller piece, which looks
may
a little
even
long.
Be this bit here.
Yeah, I think it could be that one. Sir. And that looks like it's a couple of hundred years older.
And that's the one with the tool marks?
Yes.
Yeah, so this would still be early Bronze Age.
Well, that tool mark is between 2139 and 1957 Cal BC, just with 95.4%.
So just under 4,000 years old.
Thank you. Okay. I'm going to talk to him in
just
future.
Under 4,000. That's interesting for me, having worked on the late Bronze Age settlement just about 150, 200 metres away. That's a little bit later than that. The earliest dates we got there were 1,000. 200-ish. So it's proving Bronze Age occupation in the immediate locale over quite a period of time, in the late early Bronze Age and right through to the end of the Bronze Age.
There are still important questions to be answered about Longrock, but understanding of the site has moved on today. It looks like there was human activity in the area for most of the Bronze Age, and that means for over 1,000 years. Recent history, he had the benefit of good printed records and photographs. Charlotte is visiting the museum at Sandwich to meet curator Maddie Beardmore,
and to look at some remarkable evidence of the people who worked at Port Richborough during World War One.
Ah, women.
Yes.
Look at that. That's a great photograph as well, isn't it?
It is, yeah. It's a little known part of our history that there were women working at Port Richborough.
So tell me, what were they doing?
So the women were working on salvage. It would have been shells and artillery, which would have been brought back from the Western Front on barges and train ferries. By 1917, the war had been going on for quite some time, and they realised that they needed to recycle some of the materials they were using, and they were sorted here before being sent off up to Birmingham.
Oh, right, that's interesting. And actually, yeah, this photograph here shows ladies sorting through kind of all bits of twisted metal and old artillery shells. So where did they recruit all of these women from?
Well, actually, they're recruited locally. We have another article in the Thanet Advertiser and Echo. I think they were concerned that they wouldn't be able to get anybody, so they advertised for 500 initially, and they were very, very vague about the sort of work that they'd be doing.
Yes, I can see that, because it says here they would like to enlist the services of a large number of women for war work of an important character. So it's quite elusive about what the nature of the work was going to be. And then it just says, yes, 500 women are required at once, and it is possible in the near future the number will be very considerably increased.
We know it did increase to 900, so they were able to recruit the women that they needed. And army pay wasn't that great, so it would have been really helpful for the women to have some work that could bring in some extra money to help support them.
And just looking at this photograph, it really kind of illustrates the scale of what was happening here. I mean, there's just crates upon crates stacked up. As far as the eye can see, going into the background, they've got production line here, huge piles of shells that these ladies are sorting through. I mean, it was a massive undertaking.
It was, and we do know that by the end of the war, they'd handled 163,000 tonnes of salvage, which had come back from the front, which would have been worth about £3 million, which is a lot of money in 1918.
Wow, that's incredible. Mm.
But the end of the war wasn't the end of the story of Port Richborough. The roll-on, roll-off ferries lived to fight another day.
That is a good piece of kit.
The discovery of a 16th century boat in the intertidal zone at Tankerton on the North Kent coast has grabbed people's attention locally and nationally. It's so rare to find a boat of that era, particularly in such remarkable condition. The outstanding question is, can we date it more accurately? And as a result, identify where it was built and what it was used for. I've travelled down to Salisbury to meet Rob Bale and Toby Gain to find out what more they know about the remarkable wreck they were excavating last summer.
What it looks like we've got is a real mix of timbers, a real mix of origin. We've got some German oak and some English oak. This illustrates it here really clearly. We've got the German timbers in blue, and they're slightly earlier dates, 1560s, 1570s. Whereas the English timbers are a little bit later. In fact, into the 17th century.
So it seems that the dates are fairly firm. You're going to be happy to go late 16th century, possibly into the early 17th century.
1560 to 1580, may I have.
Interesting.
It is.
Does that mean, then, that the fact that the German timbers are older, that this is a German vessel?
It could be a German vessel. But one of the things that was noted when we were out in the field was that it had some elements of Dutch design to it.
Oh, yes. Would it be typical of Dutch vessels to source their timber from, I don't know, northern Germany? That seems like a sensible potential nearby source of wood.
I think it's a possibility. You had the River Elbe coming down from North Germany, and they could have, you know, gone around the coast to Holland and the Low Countries. So, yeah, it's quite possible.
When I saw you, you were finding amazing things coming out, like actual personal finds from within the boat.
Yeah.
Can that help in any way?
Absolutely, it can help. These are two of the shoes that we found. Just roll that back. We do need to keep these wet because they're very fragile. But these tell us quite a lot, actually.
That's the bit we saw.
That is, isn't it? Yeah, that is a bit. And it's not, you know, we assumed at the time it was a sole.
Yeah.
But actually, it isn't. It's part of the side of the shoe. But what we've got is we've got two different types of shoe, and they're both absolutely right for the second half of the 16th century. They're both welted.
Would you say welted shoes? What's a welt?
So a welt is this strip of leather that holds the sole to the upper. In this shoe, we know that this is a slip-on, and it's got a single quarter at the back.
What's a quarter?
A quarter is, quarter. Is the bit of leather that wraps around your heel.
Yes.
But this shoe, it's got two quarters.
They've just stitched together at the back.
Yeah.
So, which is familiar.
It is exactly how most people's shoes are made these days. The sizing is interesting as well, because this is an adult size 2 and this is an adult size 3.
Okay.
So they are tiny, but that's normal at that time.
The other thing I remember is that you were turning up evidence of what, like the galley, there were those bricks.
Yeah.
Is that right? Did that bring anything else up?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we got some very nice finds out of the galley area. An example is this lovely spoon.
Oh.
So it's wooden. It's exceptionally delicate.
It is very delicate. It's got a very fine handle. Nice piece of carving.
Yeah, absolutely. But also we've got evidence of what they were eating. So, for example, here we've got a bit of cattle tibia. And we know from the marks on it that they were filleting off the bone. So they were cooking it in the galley and then cutting slices off to eat.
Is there anything you can say further about what the boat would have looked like?
It may have looked something like this. This is a bus, and it's an iconic type of Dutch vessel from the time.
Was there any cargo on board?
We couldn't find any evidence of cargo. I think it's likely that the local inhabitants would have come down to the vessel and would have cleared it out of pretty much everything. And we're just lucky that we've got the bits in the lowest part of the vessel that was probably flooded and full of water that they couldn't get at.
And you just must be absolutely desperate to go back and find more.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, we very much hope that we'll be able to go back because the wreck clearly has more to give. So, yeah, we'd like to get back there.
I've now come to Essex and the port of Harwich because this is where the story of the World War I secret supply depot at Port Richborough comes to a conclusion. David Whittle used to work at Harwich and knows the history of it inside out.
So, what is it we're looking at here?
We're looking at the link span of the train ferry terminal at Harwich. The link span comes from Southampton.
And that's the bridge going
that's
down?
That's the bridge. The grey thing up there is the gantry. That came from Richborough.
So I'm actually looking at, I mean, that's basically what was being used at Port Richborough in the First World War.
Yeah.
It's amazing, really. I mean, yes, it's a bit rusty, but otherwise, it looks in fairly good nick. It ended up here. Why didn't it just stay at Port Richborough?
Well, it did stay at Port Richborough after the war because there was so much equipment to bring back from France. It was used for that. And then it was envisaged that perhaps a proper service, a commercial service, would start across the Channel. But that never actually came about. And this is when, obviously, Great Eastern Railway got hold of the idea, thought of their operation at Harwich and included it in here. And what you see in front of you here started construction in the early 20s, about 22. And it wasn't until 1924, on the 24th of April, that Prince George came down here and actually opened the service.
And that was the first service from Harwich to
Zeebrugge.
Zeebrugge.
It was very far-sighted of the Great Eastern Railway, and it was a very, very successful service right up until 1987.
Really? Mm. Was that being used until 1987?
Yes, 31st of January was the last time it was used.
That is...
87.
That is a good piece of kit.
Yeah,
I mean, certainly. Considering it was built in a fair hurry during World War I, to keep going until 1987.
Yeah.
Back in London, James Ladoka has completed his drone survey of the street. He should be able to show us a 3D model of the whole structure.
It's very flat, isn't it?
Yes, yeah.
There's not much 3D to the 3D model.
One of the curious things, though, given that we're looking at this with north towards the top of the screen, is that it doesn't seem to follow the same direction as many of the other islands and spits that you find in that part of the estuary. It's sort of going against the grain a little bit, isn't it?
Yes, it's sort of going more or less northwards rather than being forced eastwards toward the North Sea.
Yeah.
Here is the swale heading ever eastwards.
Yeah.
And if you look at the sand spits here, they're going in that direction, whereas the street is going in that direction.
It's almost perpendicular to them, isn't it?
So what is it about the geology of the street that explains its unlikely position?
So in here you can see it's a slightly lighter band coming across.
Oh, yeah.
These are actually quite sort of large circular things, and it forms about quite a sinuous line coming down here.
Any evidence for quarrying or anything on those edges?
Yes, there is some evidence of quarrying petrified London clay.
When you say petrified, you mean sort of solidified, hardened?
Yes. And these petrified boulders exist throughout London clay.
Right, so these are actually boulders. What we're looking at here is not evidence of mining per se, it's evidence of mineable material. Yes. If you've got a section of of the coastline jutting out, which is this petrified London clay, this harder London clay, that's going to be more resistant to erosion than the surrounding things. So it gives you a geological substructure underlying the street here. Then the street itself, its bedrock geology may just be showing us a nice spit of hardened London clay.
Yes, you can see that this spit here may well once have extended all the way to that spit there. All that would have been dry land at one stage in the past. So there's been substantial erosion.
And just leaving the remnant of the hardest section of bedrock left. The street is the last bit standing.
Yes, the last man standing in an incredibly changing coastscape.
Coastlines create opportunities, but also dangers. Whilst the proximity of northern Kent to the rest of Europe has encouraged international trade, it's also meant that enemy fleets have made occasional raids on our coastal towns. I'm struck by how little evidence there is today of either. We have the fabulous timber wreck at Tankerton, but more often, the remains we're left with are like those at Port Richborough. Who would think that 20,000 men and women ran a huge military port here 100 years ago? Or that the street was once noisy with industry. Time has transformed this coastline, and the people who have lived here have had to adapt, in the past and now, to a changing environment, a changing economy, and a changing relationship with their neighbours on the continent of Europe.
Unearthing more treasures of history, same time next week here on Channel 4. Tomorrow night's looking sweet inside the Willy Wonka world of Cadbury, the chocolate secrets unwrapped at 8. Next, though, it's Modern Warfare with Helen Mirren at the
recent times.
Even though it's partial, what remains of it is exceptionally well preserved. That makes it quite a special thing.
What is this mysterious sandbar? Is it natural? How has it affected the lives of local people?
Visitors that came would see something rather like hell.
And we'll explore the forgotten military base that helped win World War I.
It was top secret. I don't think the Germans were aware of it, and one of the reasons they weren't aware of it was a ludicrous place to build it.
The stretch of coastline we're interested in lies on the north coast of Kent, around the town of Whitstable. Whitstable is one of the fastest growing seaside resorts in Britain. In the last decade, tourist numbers have soared. People come here for the famous natural oysters, the miles of shingle beach, and, of course, the sea. What's less well known is the wealth of archaeology in the intertidal zone. And to investigate what's there, I'm joining our team of specialist archaeologists.
We look at these seaside towns and we see them all as pleasure, but that's fairly recent. They're actually hives of industry.